God has chosen me to be within this plan. A plan to save the sinful race of man. And though I am unworthy, I can see just how much God is interested in me. To the praise of his glory, oh, how can it be that God in all his majesty could save a wretch like me? He called me from this wicked world so I could worship him. To the praise of his glory, redeemed, set free. This present world is lost and dying still, and we still call to do his blessed will, to go into all the world and say, Jesus died to be the life, the truth, the way. To the praise of his glory, oh, how can it be that God in all his majesty could save a wretch like me? He called me from this wicked world so I could worship him. To the praise of his glory, redeemed, set free. It's been joyful serving Jesus all this time. Through every fall I've learned more how to climb and mount up to the clouds on eagle's wings, that I might grow ever closer to the King of Kings. To the praise of oh, how can it be that God in all his majesty could save a wretch like me? He called me from this wicked world so I could worship him. To the praise of his glory, redeemed, set free from sin.
Coming. It's always the worst thing ever that can happen to a guitarist is when his fingernail misshapes and starts getting caught on the string. Like, what's going on? Anyway. Alright, so 447. Well, if you don't have your hymn book, it's up here, but you don't have your hymn book, I don't think. Thank you. You know, you're just in the habit of saying open your hymn books, and so but anyway. So we have it on the screen today. We're going to sing the first and last verse of Higher Ground, okay? Let's stand as we sing, all right?
On heaven's tableland.
come up and lead us in our theme song. So Lord, we just thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you for all of our people here, Lord, how they have been an amazing help to me through this year. And Lord, I thank you for my boys and my wife and just the support that everybody has been during these last months. And Lord, I couldn't have done it without them. And Lord, this is a celebration for them. And Lord, I just thank you that we can celebrate together. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand up and sing.
The whole gist of today, it's the reason why we've got so much of the decor, is you really kind of have helped me earn the degree, and so credit goes to you as well. And so I just, I'm thankful for the support that all of you have been, and so I'm going to celebrate you today. So let's go ahead and look at our hymn books, or, well, I'm sorry, I meant the screen. I said it again. Let's look at the screen. I do miss the books. All right, we're going to sing Be Strong in the Lord. You can remain seated as we sing.
Be strong. Victory is sure.
Amen. All right, we're going to go ahead and have our ushers come up and we'll take up our morning tithes and offerings. Baptist churches cannot leave out the offering. All right. No, I am so thankful for your giving and just all that you've done to support our church. And so this is your opportunity again. And so be sure to give with a heart of thanksgiving, and then I know the Lord will bless you for it. So, Josh, you want to lead us in prayer, please?
Lord, I thank you for the blessings you've given us every day. The Lord, thank you for allowing us to be here today. I want to know you represent us, Lord. I pray Charles to help pastors and Christians this morning. Give us what we stand in need of. Thank you for all the guests we have here today, Lord. Thank you for the blessings you give us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Says, render therefore to all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. I know you're probably wondering, you know, why does he keep saying that he's celebrating us? We didn't do anything. Yes, you did. You were patient with me. There were many times where I had to leave quickly in order to get a paper done. There were many times when you were careful to need me when I was needed, and you understood when I wasn't able to be a part of certain things. And I want to use today to just thank all of you for all the support that you have given. You know, there's a lot of people that they come. They ask me, it's always the same question. How many people go to your church, you know? And really, I just kind of pleasantly smile and I just say, you know, well, we're a small church. And automatically, most people go, oh, he's one of those digital places, you know. But I've got giant people. I'll tell you what, I've got quality people. And I'll tell you, there has been many bumps in the road that our family has endured, but as a result, we got you, and we have a good church. We really have a good church. You know, I think it's funny that, you know, I look back. You know, we can be a little disheveled. Sometimes we can leave a few things laying around, and I'm okay with that. You know, I love it that I remember back when we had pews for about 6 months. There was a dollar sitting on top of one of the pews. And you know, it just, I know that's not that big of a deal, but you're like, you know, what's the point? What are you talking about? Anybody could have taken that dollar, but it just stayed there. And I left it sitting there just to see, you know, how long is this thing gonna be there? And nobody took it, and I grabbed it and I put it in the offering plate, and I just thought, Lord, thank you that we have such a safe place where we can worship. We can truly worship without ridiculous arguments where we don't have to, you know, one of my professors said, you're never going to agree with me about 75% of things. He said, but it's the 25% that we must agree on. And that's how I feel about our church. there's a lot of things that are, you know, there's a lot of differences that we have. You know, clearly I was raised by Midwesterners, and you know, there's just a lot of differences in culture and things, and you know, they're the people here in Tarboro, they'll never fully accept me because I'm not from here, but at the same time, this church really has. This church considers me a family, and I'm so thankful for that. I'm thankful for what you've done in my life, the blessing that you've been in my life. I owe you honor. I really do. And I just, you know, I was just thinking about it. When these people come up, they ask me, they say, well, how many people do you have? And I'll tell them, and the next question, can you guess what the next question is? They say, well, do you work an extra job? You know? And I tell them no. And they go, you're a full-time pastor? They look surprised. And I say, you know, I really should be. I said, but I have the most amazing group of people that support me. And as a result, I can be a full-time pastor. And they go, you're really blessed. You know, it kind of changes around. And you got some of these guys that got big churches, boy, their hands are tied. But the Lord has really used you to let us work freely here. And I owe the world to you. I owe everything to my family, my boys. And I wanted to give you guys a gift. It's a little funny. It says congrats, grad. All right. And it's a pin. It's not much. It's not, you know, we did the best we could. But we've got a whole bunch of pins here, up here in the front. And I want you to come and get one, just as a gift that says thank you for being such a support to me and my family during this time that I've gone through school. I don't know, you may have noticed, I hope you've noticed, that school has made a difference in the way I handle things and the way I preach. School has taught me to go after my guys a little bit more, you know, right, Josh? And, but you know, it's been good. It's really been, I have learned a whole lot. I realized that Brother R. Scott wasn't crazy about expository preaching and preaching the whole Word of God. You know, I was like, you know, he was right. There are so many things. You know, the reason I chose to go back to school was because I had written a Sunday school lesson about patterns of holiness, and I had so much doctrine that was wrong in there. There was a lot of stuff in there that just wasn't clear. And Brother R. Scott just very gently took me through it and showed me where I needed to fix it. And he explained doctrinally, you know, what I needed to fix. And I was so grateful for his mentoring. And I just decided after that appointment that I was going to go back to school. I thought, you know, if I'm going to be a pastor, how much more important is it to be a doctor of the spirit than a doctor of the body? And I just thought, you know, I need to get my degree. I've got a degree in German, I've got a degree in accounting, but I don't have a degree in the thing that I do. So, you know, I'm not trying to make a thermometer here, but I needed an education to help me to shepherd better. And that's probably the greatest thing that I learned throughout this study was the importance of being a shepherd. There's a lot of people trying to take that word out, but it's so important that I'm a shepherd. One of the things that I am as a shepherd is I get into your business. And I've had a lot of people leave the church because I like to get into your business. But you've let me do that, and I'm thankful for that. I also have something for my guys, and so if my boys could come up here, just a little something to recognize them here. It's not much, guys, but it's just a way of letting you know how much I appreciate it. My guys, they had to leave me alone. You know, I felt like the man in the iron mask, you know. I was just kind of up there forever. I would see him out there playing out the window, and I'd be like, oh, I miss these guys so much. Bryson gave up a year taking care of my mother, and he gave up another year to help me. And so, Bryson, don't lose anything that you see inside of this thing, okay? And I love you, buddy. Thank you for being a blessing. And Judson, this is for you. and Wilson, and then this is for Harrison. And I just want to thank you guys and let you know how much I love you and appreciate you for being such an awesome support. I loved it. Bryson knew exactly when to come in and bother me. He always knew. He would say, "I think Dad is probably tired." And so he would come in and he would stick his head out the. He would go like this. He'd go. It just made my day. I forgot where I was reading and all this stuff, but I was like, "Hey, Bryson, come on over here and talk to me," you know. But it's been a rough ride, but I'm thankful for you guys. So I love you. Well, with that being said, don't worry, my wife's late. Okay. I know you're probably like, "What about Marianne?" That's coming, all right. That's coming. I've got a guest of honor here. The R. Scotts have been such an encouragement to me, and I've invited Brother Glenn and Sister Diane to come. Like I said, we understand that they just weren't able to keep coming here because they're so far away. But they were here for just the right amount of time. One of the things that Diane taught, Diane, you didn't know that I actually got the message here, but something she taught me was never hold on to anybody. My wife told me that you said that. Never hold on to anybody because you don't know how long they're going to have. You don't know how long they're going to be around or, you know, when they're going to have to leave. And, you know, when you hold on too closely to somebody, it really hurts when they have to go. And I'll be honest, I tried to let loose of them, and it hurt when they left. It really did. I'm not going to lie to you. But I'm so glad that they're still our close friends. And so I've asked Brother Glenn to come and share a few things and maybe sing for us. So.
Guest of honor part. I don't know about that. I've never been a guest of honor for anything, but I appreciate the.
Well, you are today.
I appreciate the opportunity. And do you have an official title? Are you a doctor?
No.
Because I was going to say, if you're a doctor, when's the TV program coming up? Dr. Phil, Dr. Mike.
Oh, man.
As far as going back to school, you know, and Jonathan can. To this. Going back to school in your later years is not easy. As a matter of fact, I got in trouble in grade school. I was in third grade. The teacher asked me, "Who wrote the Constitution?" I said, "I didn't do it." She said, "No." Come on. Smart aleck. But anyway, Pastor Mike, he said some nice things about me, but you know, this man has faithfully shared the word of God here. And I knew this was going to happen. But we miss him too and his family.
Yeah.
It was hard to leave, but we knew it was the right time to go.
Mm-hmm.
And he's been faithful through the years, through the thick and the thin, and mostly it's been thin. Let's just be frank. But he's hung in there and done a tremendous job. I just thought I'd share something really quick, and it will be really quick. 2 Kings chapter 8, if you have your Bible. 2 Kings chapter 8. It's talking about restore and restore. There was a certain Shunammite lady that had her son brought back to life again. In verse 1, it said, this is 2 Kings chapter 8, and context is important. Okay. You've heard that before from me. Context, context, context. You can't take a couple verses out of the scriptures and say this is what it means when
right.
There's no context to support it. So anyway, that's your...
That was a big word in school.
Yes, you had mentioned that. So, well, how about that? I wonder where that. But yeah, we were drilled about that in the Bible Institute years ago. And anyway, this Shunammite lady had her son brought back to life again. It says, then spake Elisha unto the woman whose son he had restored to life, saying, arise and go thou and thine household, and sojourn wheresoever thou canst sojourn. And then it goes on from there. And then in verse, things that Elisha has done. And it came to pass, as he was telling the king how he had restored a dead body to life, that behold, the woman whose son he had restored to life cried to the king for her house and for her land. And Gehazi said, my lord, O king, this is the woman, and this is her son, whom Elisha restored to life. And then it goes on in verse 6, and when the king asked the woman, she told him. So the king appointed unto her a certain officer, saying, restore all that was hers, and all the fruits of the fields, since the day that she left the land, even until now. Now, this one will preach. This one will really preach.
Yes, it will.
But I'll tell you, there's two words that stood out to me. Restored. We see that in verses 1 and verse 5. And the restored that's talking about is actually the word to revive. Amazing. Mm-hmm. To revive or give life again. And that's what happened to this young man. He was restored back to life. I can hear Doc Flanders saying back to normal.
Yeah.
So, and then in verse 6, the word restored, it's a different word. It's to turn back or return to the starting point. And this man has faithfully shared the word of God, how revival has to be the intricate part of your life. Being restored again, coming back to normal, as Doc Flanders used to say. It's not trusting in myself or my flesh. It's trusting in the one who can have victory through me. Even if you can do something, shared this with my wife, even before I get in a truck, Brother Bonnie, I just tell the Lord, I can't drive this truck. I can't do it. But you can drive it through me. And you might be able to be real good with your hands and work real good with your hands. If you'll start doing that and asking the Lord to work through you, it'll be amazing what he can do. It's not me working. It's him working through me. That's the revival. That's the John 10:10 way. I heard an illustration a couple weeks ago, and this one really struck me. There was two young girls that were going to the playground, and their dad was with the younger one. The one was about 8, the other one was about 4. The girl that was 8, the playground was a couple blocks away. So the girl that was 8, she was riding her little bicycle and going along pretty well. And the younger girl was getting frustrated because she couldn't keep up with her big sister. So she had the little bicycle with the training wheels. And because she was unsure about this bike, she had 1 foot on the pedal and she was pushing the bicycle with the other foot because she wouldn't trust to put her other foot on the pedal. So the dad kept encouraging, put your other foot on the pedal, but you know, it was a little shaky there. She didn't want to do it. So he grabbed the hold of the seat and told her to put the other foot on the pedal. And as they were going down the sidewalk, thinking along those lines, I can't live the Christian life, and neither can you. Not by myself.
That's right.
But when we trust Him, there's victory.
Yeah.
So let's be like that little girl. Abba, Father, I can't do it, but you can.
Amen.
So put both feet on the pedals. Let the Father hold on to the a seat and pedal your way along the way, mm-hmm. and you'll find victory there. So anyway, I just thought I'd share that. This man has been a revivalist type preacher. He might say that he's learned a lot from me, but I've learned far more from him as far as the revived life and such. All right.
Share with you, if you turn to Philippians chapter 3, I'm not gonna tarry. I know I always say that, but we do have a program here, so I'm not gonna be long here. The title of my message is Climb, and I'm gonna explain why in just a minute. But I'd like it if we could turn to Philippians chapter 3, and I just want to challenge you with a few things. I thought I was going to school because I needed to know how to be a pastor and of, you know, how to do things the right way. As a matter of fact, that was my introductory video at Veritas. I said, I really believe that, you know, a doctor has a degree as a surgeon, and I feel that it's so much more important for a pastor to have a degree in ministry. And but my wife will tell you, I went through some major personal battles this past year. I was confronted with me more than I have ever wanted to be confronted with. I was challenged about who my God was. And really, it started before Brother Glenn, and I don't even think my wife knows the whole gist of all this, but I think it's probably going to make sense to you. But as I was getting ready for what I was going to say today, what prompted me to write The Patterns of Holiness, the Sunday school book that I told you to ignore, chapter 1, right? Where I said that God put aside his godness to become a human. Well, he said it so gently. He said, I know that you believe that. He said, it's just that the way that you worded it wasn't, you know, you're going to mislead people. And that's very true. And, but the reason I wrote Patterns of Holiness was because I had just had a surgery. My wife, she's been questioning, you know, there are some battles that we faced, some major issues in the home that my boys know about. And she blames a lot of it on the surgery. And really, the surgery was sort of a catalyst for some very difficult personal battles that I was getting ready to face. I had no idea that I was going to face them. I was confronted with things about who I was that I was not ready for. I thought I was just going to get a degree. I thought I was just going to learn how to be a better pastor, you know. But I realized that I didn't know who my God was. And there's a lot of resentment and anger that had surfaced while going to school. A lot of things that I was preaching to you that as I studied and as it surfaced in my life, I realized, Mike, you are a hypocrite. You are struggling with some things toward your God that you're telling these people. And honestly, it made me a little bitter. It made me hard. And I became quite adamant. If you know Barnett's, we are very stubborn. Really, I'm what you would call the weak link in the Barnett family. You really just can't teach us anything. We're just not going to listen. We know all the answers. And if you knew me years ago, you probably knew, yeah, he was like that. There's nothing you could teach him. And I'm still like that, but I'm trying. I really am. And that's another reason why I appreciate you, is because I have been a pompous idiot so many times. But I was reading a book that I would encourage everybody to read by Andrew Murray called Abide. I think that's what it's called, Abide. My wife and I read it together. And really, this book, Abide, is what prompted me to write Patterns of Holiness. And I mean, I'm going to be honest with you, I thought this book was going to be a bestseller. I thought, this is going to help so many. This is going to help so many churches, you know. This isn't going to just help our church, it's going to help other churches. And as I look back on it, I'm like, Mike, what on earth were you talking about? As I was reading it, you know, it's just, I'm a very deep thinker, and school has taught me to not be so deep. But I realized through this book, it says in Matthew, it says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. It says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly of heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. You've heard this verse out of my mouth many times. And I was really getting a grasp of that. I had read that book. I read it a second time. pass the book around to others. And I just, you know, I was immersing myself in it, but something happened. And honestly, I can't exactly put my finger on it, but I just took a spiral downward. I'm just kind of letting you know some things that you know, I probably need to make sure that I clarify that my walk with God was still strong. It's just that I took a spiral because I realized I did not know who God was. And as a matter of fact, there were many times where I walked outside and I looked up and I said, "Who are you?" I said, "I thought I knew you all these years, but I don't think I know you as well as I thought I did." And then the devil came in and he began to point out hopelessness to me, showed me things that he basically said, "You're going to school, you're trying to better yourself." He said, "None of it's going to matter. Nothing's ever going to amount to anything in your life. You're always going to be a failure." That's what he would come and whisper to me. And there were a lot of battles, but I have had to reshape my understanding of who God is. You know, I went from one extreme where I thought he was a hard God because I was raised with hardness to a God who is loving and doesn't walk around with a baseball bat. And, you know, he's very gentle, and, you know, but he does chasten folks. He does chasten still. He whenever he chastens you, understand, it says that he does it for our profit. And what that means is when you get a spanking from mom and dad, all right, that's the end of it, pretty much. It says in the Bible, it says that we get disciplined by our parents here on earth, so that they can live their life a little bit easier. You know, it's for their gain. But it says that he chastens us for our profit, meaning that when we get chastened, we don't despise it because he actually is doing something in our life. And I went deep into a pit. And through this year, I've had to climb. And that's the name of this message. And I want us to look at Philippians chapter 3 and verse 12. It says, "Not as though I had already attained." Or I'm sorry. But let's look at verse 10. Here, this is the gist of it, okay? This is the gist. "That I may know him." There it is, all right? "Take my yoke upon you and learn of me." I wanted to know him. "Take my yoke upon you, that I may know him, and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death." You know, I've never been able to understand fully what it means to die to self, but this year I was confronted with it so many times. There were times, one of my favorite teachers was Dr. Forrester, he loved my work, but there were so many times where I had to vent to him. He was a blind pastor, did amazing things. I mean, you know, don't ever let somebody tell you that you can't do anything and you're blind. I mean, this guy has planted churches on every exit in his area, done some great things. But I would write down, you know, I would just kind of vent to him. But he was so gentle, and he would say, you know, "Maybe you should consider this. And, you know, you're being too hard on yourself." And, you know, and we would kind of communicate with one another. I don't know how he was able to read my stuff. So I'm sure he probably listened to some of it, but there were times where he would be, he had his little computer, no screen, of course, because he's blind, but he'd put his fingers there and he would read the King James Bible. I'm like, okay, I can understand reading a Bible, but you can read this. What in the world's going on through those fingers that you got on that keyboard, you know? But he was brilliant. But I was confronted with a lot of things that I needed to face that I was unwilling to face. But he says, "I want to be made conformable unto his death." Look at verse 11. "If by any means I may attain unto the resurrection of the dead." Now here's where our acronym comes. "Not as though I had already attained, neither already perfect, but I follow after, that I may apprehend, that I may attain, that I may get, all right, that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do." He's saying, I haven't arrived yet, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. "Let us therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded. and if in anything ye be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. Nevertheless, whereto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us mind the same thing. Now, let's pray. Lord, I pray that you would just help us as we consider these points. I'm trusting that you'll illumine the word. Lord, I realize that there's nothing, as Brother Glenn said, there's nothing that I can do apart from you. And I am praying that you would illumine the hearts. Illumine my heart, illumine these people. Thank you, Lord, for the things that you've already shown me that I didn't know I was really going to say. But I just pray that you would continue to take this message and use it for our people who are here, for everybody that's listening. Lord, I trust that it's going to be a help. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, when you're young and you're going to school, you come out of school cocky and arrogant. You know, you've seen it before. You know, these young guys, they come out, they think they know everything. And they come back to church and they're like, "Here, Pastor, let me show you how it's done." You know, that kind of thing. When you've been in the ministry for a number of years, it's humbling when you go back to school. But I want to look at the acrostic on the screen here. These are the points, and I'm just going to go ahead and give them to you. Commit to the goal. Leave the past behind. Intensify your pursuit. Maintain a right attitude. And be consistent in your walk. These are some things that I learned while I was going to school. The first verse in verse 12, it says, "Not as though I had already attained, either already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend, that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus." Commit to the goal. Can I just say, you're not too old. There's nobody in here who's too old. I don't know. Our church has struggled with apathy. Everybody does. Everybody struggles with it. But sometimes apathy comes because we feel like, you know, it's too late for me. It's never too late. I follow after, if that I may apprehend. In Hebrews 12, verse 1 and 2, it says, "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus." We forget everything in the past. We look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Every day, commit to the goal of giving God the pen every day. That's one of the reasons that I chose to give you a pen today. On the pen, when you get it, it's going to say, "Take pride in how far you've come. Have faith in how far you can go. But don't forget to enjoy the journey." That was something else that I had heard from a dear man over at the Wilds when I took Wilson. The last thing he said to me, I came up to him, I said, "I just wanted to thank you for the messages that I heard. They were really real blessing." And he smiled at me and he goes, "Enjoy the journey." It just really stuck with me, you know, when he said that. But it was really, really powerful. Enjoy the journey. You're on a journey. You just give God the pen. He's going to write your story. It doesn't matter where you're at. It doesn't matter where you're at in life. He's going to write your story. And sometimes God might lead you back to school. Sometimes he might lead you overseas. There's no telling what God could do, but he's, as long as he has the pen, you're going to make it. G. Campbell Morgan said, "Whatever I cannot do, I do it in the power of the Lord." That's really a very powerful statement. "I will do it in the power of the Holy Ghost." That's what he said. 1 Corinthians 9:24 says, "Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that ye may obtain." So commit to the goal. Decide you're going to do it. Buy the big bottle of shampoo. You know, don't buy the, you know, "I'm going to try this out for a little while." No. Buy the big one where it's going to last for a long time. You're going to stay faithful to, you're going to commit to that one thing. That's something that's necessary. And this really is for our young guys, but this is something for everybody here. But commit to that goal. Then we have L for climbing. Leave the past behind. Just forget about the past. You're never, you know, that's, I always, my love for the Irish, you know. One of the things those poor people cannot do is let go of the past. They're always looking backward. You know, "I remember when things were better. I remember what the 60s had, the 80s took away, you know. I remember the 80s were actually fairly good, you know." But the thing is we can't do anything about the past. The past is like a rocking chair. And if you know, there's different things that we can hold on to in our past. Sometimes we can't let go of sins that we've committed. But God, when he justified you, he literally looks at you when you say, Lord, I'm sorry about my past sins. He literally, just like the song, what are you talking about? He's justified you. You have Christ's righteousness. If you're going to keep apologizing for the things that you've done in the past, you're basically telling, you're letting him know that Christ's righteousness isn't good enough. He's covered all that. Press onward. Leave the past behind. You might have made some mistakes. I'll tell you, I've made some mistakes. I've made some mistakes this past year, but I got to leave it behind. So it says in verse 13, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, and reaching forth unto those things which are before. So he's saying, I haven't gotten there yet, but I'm going to get it, and I'm going to forget everything that's behind me. You might say, I'm too old. Leave that behind you. You might say, I'm not smart enough. Leave it behind you. I had somebody, I can't remember who it was, but they said, I never listened in school, so I'm just kind of done for. That's not true. Leave it behind you. Start today. While it is said today, Isaiah 43 says, remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall ye not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. I'll never forget Oriel's message. I loved Oriel's message when he was speaking. He said, I'm going to do a new thing. Stop thinking about the Red Sea. You know, he said, the Red Sea, you know, that you guys walked through a wet wilderness on dry ground, all right? He said, but I'm going to do a new thing. You're going to walk through a dry wilderness and springs are going to come up. And that's a new thing. Luke 9:62, and Jesus said unto him, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Don't look back. Remember Lot's wife. Looking back's just going to mess things up. Then intensify your pursuit. That's the third point. In verse 14, look what it says. I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Are you having a hard time pursuing God? Intensify your pursuit. Decide, you know what, I'm gonna make it harder on myself. You know, that's one of the things that some of us here say, well, I'm not a reader. Get over that and start reading. The worst thing that you can do is to say I'm not a reader. You have got to read. It's important that you obtain knowledge, that you acquire knowledge, that you grow. You may not be a fast reader. Get something on Audible. It's not necessarily about reading as much as it's learning. It's obtaining. So intensify your pursuit after God. How important is he to you? You say, I can't, you know, I'm not a good reader, so I'm just not going to learn about that stuff. The Holy Spirit will give it to me. Oh, no, he won't. No, the Bible says that we must learn of him. We must learn of him. We learn it through listening to messages. We learn it through books. We learn it through education. You know, some of you might end up going back to school because of this. But look, I'm just encouraging you. It's never too late. Intensify your pursuit. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Maintain a right attitude. Verse 15 says, let us therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded. And if in anything ye be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. Boy, I'll tell you what, going through school, I had a bad attitude a lot of times. There were a lot of times where I told Marianne, I said, I'm done. I'm not going to finish. I can't do this anymore. And my wife kept on encouraging me. She said, you're going to finish this. We are going to finish this. We are going to finish this. And when she said we, are going to finish this, I was like, okay, I'll do it. Romans 12:2 says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Renew your mind. It may not be through school, but at least get in the Word. At least read one verse a day. You might not be reading anything. At least pick up a little bit. Read one verse a day. Maintain a right attitude. God is good. Wake up every morning and say, God is good. Look, you're looking at a guy who wakes up every morning and really wants to say, God isn't good. You know, there are times where I get up in the morning. When I wake up in the morning, my arthritis in my feet are killing me. And I literally have to walk out of bed like this. And I look like an 80-year-old man getting up out of bed. Sorry, Maurice. Probably needed to be more careful about what I said. But seriously, I'm 45 years old. And the devil always comes up to me and he says, look at you. What have you done? And I have to get in the mirror and look at myself and say, God is good, Mike. God is good. Finally, be consistent in your walk. Don't quit. And don't say, I'm going to do this Monday and then not do it. The reason why I gave you the Red Sea rules, don't worry, I'm not going to punish you again, all right? Maybe not for a while, all right? This was good for you. This taught you consistency. I did this on purpose. I encouraged Josh to get this. I don't even think Josh knew how much work was going to be in it. But I encouraged him. I said, you need to let him do this one, you know? And I did it because it helps you to grow some consistency. You either did it or you didn't. But this, if you didn't do it, would you please go back and do it? Because this is really this will help you with your walk. Be consistent with your walk. It says in verse 16, nevertheless, whereto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule, let us mind the same thing. Let's encourage one another to be consistent. Galatians 5:25, if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit consistently. James 1:22-25 says, be doers of the word and not hearers, only deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. It basically means, oh man, look at that big mark on my face. I got to do something about that. And you walk away and you forget about it. And then you go to church and everybody's like, you need to wipe your face off. You know, they remind you, you know, hey, what do you mean there's something on my face? It's none of your business, right? That's how it is with spirituality. There's a big mark on your spirit. You need to get that off. Well, you know what? That's what church is all about. We exhort one another. You know, if you're not good with roses, boy, she's upset, isn't she? If you're not good with roses, you're going to watch the gardener when he's pruning. You're going to go, what is he doing? Because he almost cuts off all the branches, cuts off all the goodness. And you know what? When that happens, we tend to wonder, God, why? There's not a single rose left on the bush. But when we learn to trust him, we realize, you know what? He's doing that so that I can produce more. And do you know that you can actually salvage an old rose bush? If it's taken care of enough, you can actually salvage an old rose bush. It's never too late to start pursuing God. It's never too late to start climbing. I wanted to encourage you with that. And I wrote a song. I owe my wife more than anybody. She's been wanting me to write a song for a long time. But I just I wanted to give these to you first. And just wanted to say thank you for bearing with me to walk with. Don't open that yet. This song is really for you guys. It's kind of about me and my wife and my boys, but at the same time, it can be for everybody. It's called Roses. I'm going to try to get through this thing. I remember when we started off the adventures that we share. We had so many hopes and dreams, and we knew that God was there. We knew all things were possible because God would lead the way. And this triangle that we enjoy would bring roses every day. Yet when things gained momentum and the roses began to bloom, It's then the Lord stood by us and said, it's time to prune. It seemed that every rose was cut and lying on the ground. As I looked upon the branches, not a single rose was found. There were roses, roses, lying still upon the ground and fading. In these years we've been together, we've endured some trying days, so many disappointments in so many, many ways. Sickness, death, betrayal, daily changes and goodbyes. As we watched amid the rain and tears, our dreams fading before our eyes. There were roses, roses, amid the rain and tears, fading roses. Yet remember this, O weeping one, when the tears do blind your eyes. God's working when you cannot see, when hope seems to die. And with each storm that comes our way, oh, rejoice amid the rain. For with every dark and stormy time, there are roses after pain. There are roses, roses, with every storm that passes, there are roses. He never wastes the pain and loss, and he never will forsake. He's always there to comfort you and to guide you all the way. So worship and adore him, praise him through the bitter tears, for it's tears that feed the roses that increase year after year. There are roses, roses, and with every tear that falls, more roses. There are roses, roses, I'm learning more with every storm. There are roses, there are roses, many roses. Lord, I just pray that you would help us as we fellowship, Lord, and just enjoy the rest of our time. Lord, I just thank you for my friends here. I thank you for our roses, Lord. Lord, as we consider these things, Lord, you've given us so many. And I just thank you. Lord, we just pray that you would just bless the food and the fellowship that we have together. The afternoon service, Lord. And we just thank you, Lord, that you always give us the ability to climb. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Thank you, guys. Oh, I forgot I was supposed to ask John.
That's okay.
Sorry, John.
That's quite all right. So I'm going to say a few things and then.
I'm sorry, John.
Then we'll pray for you. Again. So I'm gonna say this. My I listened to a preacher's song and listened to his message. I can tell you when I met him many years ago now, I can't even remember the date, but it's been a while now. biggest things I appreciate about my pastor is he's real.
Yeah.
And through day one till now, he's been consistent in being real. He'll let you know his faults. He'll let you know his strengths, his weaknesses. And I think it's important as a church body that we see that. So many times pastors are put up on a pedestal, and I think they should be to some degree, but they're put up on a pedestal. Mm-hmm. And almost in some places you see the pastor be worshipped more than the God that the pastor's following.
That's true.
That is not the case here. And so, Pastor, I want to say thank you for that.
Amen.
Thank you for being real.
Amen.
I'm going to read a couple of verses that I feel like might, maybe, give an encouragement to those that have watched our pastor grow. And I can say I have seen you grow. But I believe it's because of this. In Isaiah chapter 1, verse 16, it says, "Wash you and make you clean, put away evil of your doings from before mine eyes, and cease to do evil." Verse 17, and this is important, it says, "Learn to do well. Seek judgment, relieve the oppressed, judge the fatherless, plead for the widow." I don't make a habit of giving life verses to other people. But I believe that my pastor, if I could give a verse to you, it would be this verse because I've seen you live it. You've learned to do well, and you continue to learn to do well. He has spent time this last year going through all of this school for himself, yes, but more importantly for his God and for the people of his church. He has a desire in his heart to better himself to serve God. And that, I don't care what profession you're in, I don't care what you do as a person, it is important to learn to do well. Whatever job you, any employer out there, any family member, anybody you love, if you ask them, what do you desire of your kids? What do you desire of a friend? What do you desire of anybody? Learn to do well. That's what God desires of us. He doesn't desire that we do everything perfectly. He desires that we learn. And so, Pastor, thank you for learning. Thank you for teaching and allowing us to learn. And that's what I'm going to say on that. I do want to say also that he celebrated us fairly well. Thank you for that. He did. His message climate is just... it's here. I don't know how else to describe it. I don't know a good word for it. I need to read one. But we want to celebrate you now. And so the meal this afternoon, the things that will be done through this next little bit, we want to focus on you and celebrate you. In doing that, we have been talking as a group, and some of us have talked, and I want you to come back up here for a minute if you don't mind. Okay. We've been talking, and we want to, you'll have some gifts and things, cards and different things. I mean, that's consistent with the graduation. But we had this little idea that something that we could celebrate you with. We know you have a heart for our work. Mm-hmm. So we as a church family are going to do this for you. And it's an Ireland Travel Fund. We're going to set up a jar in the back. Alicia will set it up. Are you going to send it back? I'm about to tell you. So if you have been led to do so, and we sent messages out about all this, but if you've been led to do so, give to the Preacher's Travel Fund. Right? And this is a trip not just for him. We know he has a heart for Ireland. He wants to travel. He wants to see it. He has friends there. He wants to go visit. You know, but we thought about it. We were like, well, we can get the plane tickets and we can send you. That would be great. We can do that, right? But it's not just about that. We know you want to be able to carry your family and celebrate that as a family. So this is something we can do as a small token of saying thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for doing, being dedicated to what you've done.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
So that'll be set up back there, and whatever's put in it is yours to put towards that fund. Thank you. Thank you, love you.
Thank you all so much.
All right, now we'll pray and be dismissed. We'll be dismissed to the food that's in the back and the celebration. Remember to say thank you. Yes, sir.
Jonathan, we want to make sure we give them enough so it's not a one-way ticket.
True. True. So, but we will.
Right.
We're going to pray, and the food will be set up back there here momentarily. And remember to walk by and talk with the pastor. This is his, while he celebrated us during the service, we want to celebrate him now. So walk by and tell him thank you. Walk by and tell him he's done a good job. He has learned, and he's doing a good job. So do that. Yes, ma'am?
Not everybody knows this, but this man got straight A's.
That is a feat in and of itself. Finishing is a feat. Finishing with straight A's is just awesome. So let's pray. Father, we thank you today for the blessings you've given.